Alumni and friends, please welcome Vice President for Student and Campus Life, Ryan Lombardi.
Good morning. It's great to see you all, and congratulations again, Chuck. What a well-deserved recognition. That means you gave me 2 more minutes in my time this morning, right? I appreciate it very much. I'm delighted to be here with you this morning. You might think, given this cool headset I have on, that I'm going to sing for you, but I promise that's not the case. If I can tell, oh, Jim's ready for me to go. I promise I won't subject you to that at this hour. I know that some folks seem to be still, must be rising out of their bed from their festivities last night, given some of the empty tables. But I'm delighted to be here to talk with you today about the residential experience at Cornell. I want to talk a little bit about where we've been, where we are now. Most importantly, give you the opportunity to hear from some of our students, our best and brightest, and then finally tell you a little bit about where we are going. So early on, when Cornell was founded, as many of you will recall, it was hoped and the vision was that lodging and dining would not be in fact provided by Cornell, but rather by the citizens of the community of Ithaca. A dormitory system was deemed as highly undesirable. In A.D. White's words, large bodies of students collected in dormitories often arrive at a degree of turbulence which small parties gathered in the houses of citizens seldom, if ever, reach. No private citizen who lets rooms in their own house of 4 to 6 students would tolerate for an hour the anarchy which most tutors in charge of college dormitories are compelled to overlook. So the feelings were quite strong early on that we should not be in the business of housing our students and providing that oversight at all. But in fact, we did very early on with that commitment at Cascadilla Place. Although again, A.D. White described it as an ill-ventilated, ill-smelling, uncomfortable, and ill-looking house. And apparently, running water in the building was so commonly out of order that often outdoor restrooms were provided. Nonetheless, Cascadilla Place was the center of student life early on in the history of Cornell. However, obviously, the coeducational experience was not being realized, and therefore, Sage Hall was constructed in 1874 to support and attract and retain women students. That was a gift from Henry Sage under the condition that instruction shall be offered to young women by the Cornell University community as broad and as thorough as that now afforded to young men in 1874. That's right. And this commitment, of course, continued in 1913 and 1929 when Risley Hall and Balch Hall, respectively, were constructed. Today, Balch remains the one all-women's residence hall on campus. So early on in 1925, this was the vision for what West Campus would look like. You recognize the Gothics there, Baker Court, Founders Hall, and the original vision for what West Campus would look like in 1925. However, there was a change of plans. You see the Gothics retained there, but then you see what, in my mind, become the infamous University Halls, or U-Halls. I've heard lots of stories about the U-Halls. Sturdy. Would that be a good way to say it? They weren't going anywhere. Take shelter if a tornado comes through Ithaca. U-Halls were the place to be. Perhaps not the most engaging or community development-minded buildings, but certainly very sturdy at that. Those, of course, opened on West Campus in 1954. Here's a shot from 1962. The Greek system also played a prominent role and has continued to play a prominent role at Cornell University since its inception. Given that principle and that belief that we would not be in the housing business, 7 IFC fraternities were a part, opened at, essentially simultaneously to the opening of Cornell. And then in 1881, the first sorority, Kappa Alpha Theta, and in 1906, Alpha Phi Alpha, Black Greek Letter Organization, the first in the country, was founded also at Cornell. So the Greek system has long played an important role in the history of Cornell and as part of our housing portfolio. And in the mid-1900s, program houses developed quite extensively at Cornell as well. Risley, the Ecology House, Holland International, Ujamaa, Just About Music, Luego, the Cultural Living Center, and Latino Living Center. There's also a language house at Cornell, which is part of the West Campus house system right now. But the program houses have also long played an important role in Cornell's residential experience. The vision was provided in 1996 then by the Board of Trustees, and the first time that the institution really made a very strong and vocal commitment to providing a residential experience for our students. You can see that vision statement right here and what we were striving for in those principles. You then know what happened on the North Campus in 2001 as that initiative took place up on the North Campus residential experience, bringing all first-year students together on North, a principle that remains today and something that we remain very committed to and we'll talk more about moving forward. And then also, shortly thereafter, the development of the West Campus house system. There's a shot of the Flora Rose House. And Hunter Rawlings, which I had the pleasure to work with for a year here in my short time at Cornell, and got to really spend a lot of time with him talking about the development of both North and West Campus. It was a real delight to do that with him. It is, I will say, one of the first questions that Hunter asked me in one of our very first meetings. Brian, tell me how West Campus is going. How's everything working out? He wanted to know right away, so I was pleased to tell him that it's thriving and doing quite well. But he was obviously very committed to the residential experience. So where we stand today is that we have a very broad variety of housing options for our students in traditional residence halls, program houses, our townhouses up on North Campus, the West Campus house system, our college town residence halls, including Cascadilla Place, still stands. There is running water on a regular basis. Co-ops, Greek chapter houses, and graduate housing. In 1996, when that residential program statement was derived, we did make a commitment to house all first and second year students on campus through a guarantee, and also all transfer students. We had that guarantee in place. We had to step back from the transfer guarantee just a couple years ago, although we still have been able to honor transfer students living on campus. We did step back from that transfer guarantee given the growing enrollments. There has not been a housing requirement. Despite the fact that we say all first-year students who do live on campus will live up on North, we actually don't require all of our first-year students to live on campus. We have a number of students who choose not to. You might recall that we had a 12-year-old engineering student come through the doors a few years ago. We didn't require him to live in the residence halls. I don't know if his parents would have been okay with that. And of course, we have the West Campus house system that's thriving. We have the lottery process for that and the Active Citizens Program for upper-level students to continue past their sophomore year there. You will see that over the years, in the last 20 years, the enrollment at the institution has steadily grown. And this reflects about a 20-year snapshot that you can see on the screen here. At the same time, though, our commensurate bed count has not kept pace with that. And as you look here specifically at the undergraduate enrollment against our bed count, because the vast majority of our energy in the residential experience has been focused on undergraduates, again, has not kept pace. And that has created some unintended outcomes and pressures on our students. We're going to hear a little bit more about their experiences here in just a couple of minutes, but this is an important point to note. So today, we only have the capacity to house about 5% of our graduate and professional students, as you see here. I'm very excited to say that in the fall, a new graduate housing complex where Maplewood Place was will open. Maplewood was demolished, and now a new project that will be more than double the size of Maplewood will open this fall, which will move our dial from 5% to 16% of our graduate and professional student population. So that's a very important step forward for us in our commitment to the graduate students and professional students at Cornell. Most of the rest of what you'll hear will be focused on undergraduate and the rest of our vision and plan going forward, given that we have this in the works for our graduate students. Undergraduate housing is virtually at 100% occupancy all the time. We quite simply do not have enough housing for our students. We cannot accommodate all those that want to live on campus. We cannot actually guarantee 2 years of housing, though we still say we do. We actually do not have the capacity to do that right now. It's interesting, I was when we were going through a housing master planning process, which I'll talk more about, I came across an article from the Cornell Daily Sun in 1961 entitled, The Forgotten Sophomore. So many years ago, we were already feeling the pressure of not being able to house as many of our students as they would prefer, as we would like to do. And you can see that bears out today in terms of by class year, how many students we are able to house on campus. Again, virtually all of our first year students do live on campus, but just a portion of our second year and even a smaller portion of our third and fourth year students live on campus today. You look at where that places us against some of those other schools that like to call themselves our peer. Here, in terms of our housing capacity, we are near the bottom in terms of our ability to support our students in their residential experience here at Cornell. And so we looked at the Ivy schools and other schools very like ours to try to get a sense of where we stand in our ability to house students. We've also looked at whether or not other schools do have these housing requirements, and as part of that guarantee, actually saying that a core principle of the experience is to live on campus. And amongst this peer set, we're the only ones that don't have some type of requirement for our students to stay on campus at all, as you see here. So that's where we've been and where we are today. I'm going to invite a few students to the stage now so that they can share with you a little bit more about their experience through residential housing at Cornell, tell you a little bit about how it has shaped their undergraduate experience and let you hear a little bit from them, and then we'll come back and go to the future. So with that in mind, I'll invite Kiana Rowe, Kiana Early, Katie Stanley, and Dustin Lewis. You think it was hard getting up yourself this morning? This is really early in the student world, please. So like I said, they're each going to take a couple of minutes and tell you a little bit about their experience, and I think Keon is going to kick us off.
Can everyone hear me? Perfect. You guys are doing a great job. So my name is Keon Rowe. I'm a senior in the ILR school, studying consecutive time. Was everything heard just now?
Yeah.
Studying to become a public sector HR professional. So that's why I'm at ILR school, to bring a lot of the work, labor, capital understandings back to public school systems. So we can do the clap now. And I'm here to speak about not just residence halls, but homes, right? The home that I left in Brooklyn, New York houses a family of three at the moment. My mom and my dad. My mom is a breast cancer survivor, and my dad is physically impaired, retiring. And part of my responsibilities back home is to make sure that they were okay. There are a number of different skills that you learn in a high school setting. As a smart little kid, you can help your parents through. There's a lot of things that you can do as a big guy to help out someone who has physical impairments. And I think that leaving home was a big decision. And I left home because I was housed during my diversity nursing experience at Ujamaa Residential College. Is that familiar?
Yeah.
So Ujamaa Residential College is celebrating its 45th anniversary this year. But part of my experience was going there and finding family, finding home, finding brothers. I was housed by a number of people who let me know that there was an opportunity for me to thrive at Cornell because they themselves were thriving at Cornell. I found an opportunity for me to come and say, hey, these are going to be my brothers when I come. After living in my freshman year, I went and became an RA. Is that familiar? Resident advisor. A major part of many of your residential experiences, and I was at the Latino Living Center, because I decided that after having lived in a home that is protected for 44 years or 48 years at that time, I needed to live in a space where I could defend somebody else's home against discussions of removed funding, against discussions of segregation taking place on our campus, because I found that that was incredibly distasteful, or at least separate from the experience that I was having in my residential experience. It didn't match up with my home. And after spending 2 years as a resident advisor, I left campus and went and worked in D.C. for a semester. Washington, D.C., familiar with something? And working in the federal government, I felt as though I was under attack at work, but also away from home, right? Away from the residential experience that at some point I was governing. I don't know if I was doing a great job. One of my residents is here, so she can tell you about that. But part of the experience was saying, hey, there are people who are attributing their success at Cornell to your work, and you aren't there. And in doing so, in truly understanding the impact that you can make in a residential space as a resident advisor, I came back to Los Angeles Living Center, not to be an RA anymore, but to be a resident, to try to contribute meaningfully to a space that had helped me through my living learning experience at Cornell. And here I am. I'm not quite sure I can say I'm thriving, but it is part of my pitch that Cornell's residential spaces have defined my ability to thrive. Some of us don't count how important it is to live in a space that's safe, that's secure, that's affirming. And when we go through our Cornell experiences, we're not in class thinking to ourselves, boy, home is pretty good. But often, home is pretty good. And I think about the opportunity to make a difference as an alum. When I finish up this year, the plan is to define my alumnihood by contributing to residential spaces, to make sure that student campus life has the funds that it needs, or the time, or the insights, the technical knowledge, to contribute meaningfully to the residential experiences of students just like me. So again, I thank you so much for the time, and remember, home is important.
You're going to have to bear with me. I'm not as good with public speakers. Kiana here, so I have notes written down. But my name is Kiana Early. I am also class of 2018, and I'm a policy analysis management major in the College of Human Ecology. I was Kiana's resident my sophomore year, even though we are the same year, but I will get to that in a little bit. So I am the president of Residential Student Congress, which is why Vice President Lombardi asked me to speak to you all today. And for those of you who don't know, Residential Student Congress is the governing body responsible for representing all of Cornell's undergraduate residents. And I take that responsibility really seriously because, as Keon was saying, where you live has such an impact on the rest of your Cornell experience, and being in a safe and caring community is so impactful to your academics, to your extracurriculars, to your social life, etc. And so, in my time at Cornell, it's coming to a close. I've noticed perceptions play a large role in how people view their housing at Cornell. So, as you all probably know, so all first-year students want to live in Donovan, or CKB, which is one of the newer dorms. I lived in Balch my first year at Cornell. Yes, loved Balch, but I still recall, so I'm from Buffalo, New York, and there is a diner that we used to hang out with after high school. It was during finals week sometime, and it was called Cobblers. I don't know if anyone's familiar with it, probably not. But I still remember getting the email with my housing assignment. It was sometime late June, I believe. And I was with another friend that I went to high school with and also was at Cornell now. And she got assigned to CKB, and I got assigned to Balch. And everyone was like, oh, I feel so bad for you. You guys live in an all-female dorm. It's like old, and it's horrible. Like, it's like all this kind of perception that I got before I even arrived at Cornell. I just felt that was not like, an unfair way to come into to college, moving away from home for the first time, and all of that. So I loved Balch. I met some great people there. One of my best friends to this day was my sink mate, as we call them. I had a single, she was with a single next door, and we shared a sink. For those of you who don't know how Balch is constructed, but and so still one of my best times to this day. And then sophomore year, everyone wants to live out west. I live in the Cornell Living Center as Keon's resident. One also a great experience. And so one of the experiences was great. One of the experiences not so great, but that was more due to the people I lived with and not necessarily the location. Because both of those locations were very affirming and very safe communities I found for myself at Cornell, and like outside of academics, outside of classes, but communities I could go to, and I felt like I thrived in. And I really believe that's why this expansion that Vice President Lombardi is speaking of is so important, because we need more of those spaces. And not only the construction of the new buildings, but also the renovation of the older buildings, so they're equitable compared to everywhere else on campus. And that way, more people have the opportunity to live on campus and also to create those communities that are so important to thriving at Cornell as a student. And so, as I said before, I did live in the Cornell Living Center, and that necessarily wasn't by choice, because I had a bad spot in the housing lottery. Ended up really loving the location, but I wasn't living with a lot of friends because they were on West, they were in College Town, and I didn't really have that community. I made a community, but I didn't have that community going in. So it was kind of a lot like my first year when I was going through not really knowing anyone that I was living with. And so I worked on as part of resident of student congress and improved the housing lottery. Because it used to be that you would get a housing slot and you would pick friends to join you, and then you would get good housing if you were at the top and not so good housing if you were on the bottom. And just that's compared more to the perceptions of housing and campus as I talked about. And we kind of changed that a little bit, so now you pick a group of people to live with first, and that group gets a housing time slot. So like, even if you are not living in, you know, the good dorms, you still have that community and that group of friends that you're living with, and so you feel like you have that community and that safe environment when you get out of classes. That's something I'm really proud of that we've done here. And it's just extremely important to enhance that Cornell experience. And then we're also working on creating, as Ms. Lombardi was talking about, like the program houses and Kian mentioned that are so important to a lot of communities at Cornell. And so we just recently passed a resolution to create a LGBTQ+ program house, not only to house, LGBTQ+ students, but also to create that community where they all can feel like they can gather and have programs and do all the sorts of things that they didn't have the space for before. So that's all I wanted to share with you, but I do think those programs in that community is so important to be a student at Cornell.
Good morning, everyone. This is really exciting to be here. One of my favorite professors at school did a speaking course and told us that no matter what, you should never talk to a hungry audience. So I'm really glad everyone has a nice plate of food. I hope you're enjoying it. My name is Katie Stanley. I'm currently a senior in the School of Hotel Administration. There we go. Fantastic. And today I'm really excited to share a little bit about my residential experience with you. And my residential experience is twofold. I lived on campus for 2 years, but then I also have this unique lens through my involvements on campus that kind of represents what prospective students and families think about the residential experience, and I'm going to touch on both of those. I really hope that I'm able to share with you today how important the residential process is for students on Cornell's campus. You've already heard about that. Hopefully the message is starting to resonate with you. But I also want to drive home the point of how important it is to continue investing in these communities, because it is such an important part to student life, and that's why I was so excited to be asked to speak on this panel, and why I'm really looking forward to you hearing about the future housing plans today. So beginning with my freshman year, I like to describe my residential experience as character building. I lived in Clara Dixon Hall. Anyone lived in Dixon? Yes? Can I see a show of hands? Now, how many of you that lived in Dixon lived in a triple? Yeah, a lot of the hands go down. I still see a few though. This was the character building experience, because there aren't a lot of triples in Dixon. I still remember I could sit on my bed and I could lean to either side and touch almost all of my belongings in the room. So that was a really close environment. But it was a lot of fun. It really started to define my Cornell experience, because when I came to campus, I knew absolutely no one. That's actually wrong. I knew one person. I knew Heather Fortenberry, who's sitting in the back, and I knew Heather because she led the information session when I visited. But coming to campus as a freshman and not knowing anyone, when you walk into this dorm and you know that there's 20 to 40 other kids that live on the same floor of you, that's something that's really exciting. So I was one of the most enthusiastic students on my floor. I convinced one of my roommates to bake cookies with me in our residential kitchen, and then go door to door down the hallway, handing out cookies and introducing ourselves to all the other people on the floor. And that's how we started to make friends. It was fun. This is the kind of thing that's acceptable to do in a freshman dorm. It's not weird when someone shows up with cookies at your door in the middle of the night. So I really had a great time with that. The people on these floors, though, they become the people that you eat meals with. One of the most important things I thought Keon touched on was talking about a home. And when I think of home, I think of having dinner with my family. And my first 2 nights on campus, I didn't have my family to have dinner with, but I did have all of these new people from my floor, these new friends. And it was just the most incredible and comforting thing to know that there were students going through a similar experience as I was, that we could now become really good friends, some of my best friends even to this day. This environment was also my first true taste of diversity. I'm from a town called Friendswood, Texas. It's a small little town with a pretty homogenous population. But living on my freshman floor and taking cookies to all of my neighbors, I learned that some of the other residents in the halls were from places like India, from Canada, from Nepal, and then of course from all across the United States. So yesterday, President Pollock talked about diversity and inclusion and how important it is, and some of you asked questions about diversity and inclusion, and we all know that it's something that's being worked on at every university right now, how important it is. And I think at Cornell, one of the most genuine interactions you have with this idea of diversity and inclusion, one of the best ways that it plays out, takes place in the residential halls and the residential communities. My floor in particular had a tradition that we called life stories. So every Sunday, we would all gather in the common room. We would pack in there. It's a lot of fun, especially without air conditioning in August. But two students would share their life stories. So you would get to hear about where they came from, what their upbringing was like, what their traditions were from their home. And it really, like I said, it was that first piece for me of diversity and inclusion and showing me how much it matters to invite everyone to the party and how much it matters to talk to everyone while you're there. Now, thinking about things from a prospective student point of view, two of my favorite activities that I've been involved with while at Cornell are being a tour guide. Any tour guides? Oh, good. Corey should be in here somewhere. You kind of know. But being a tour guide and also helping with orientation. And these have been really fun experiences that have allowed me to interact with students who are looking at Cornell or who are just getting to Cornell. So from the tour guide perspective, there's always a section of our tour where we talk about residential living. And let me tell you, families are absolutely amazed when we tell them about the diverse options of living on campus, the fact that you can live on campus for multiple years, you can be in something like a program house, you can live in your fraternity or sorority house, you can live on West Campus, you're guaranteed housing freshman and sophomore year. These are things that really get a lot of piqued interest, and I can genuinely say in that most of our question and answer sessions, a lot of the questions that people have are about what the residential living experience is like, because they're concerned, they're moving away from home, and that's a big piece for them that's really important. So to hear that Cornell has this program in place where they really, really focus on what that freshman living experience is like is huge for them. They'd love to hear that. Some of the things they get really excited about when we tell them, I always share freshman year, one of my favorite memories is that on the first night of finals around midnight, when everyone's still up studying, they take a break, they go out to the quad and they scream. It sounds funny, but it's a lot of fun. I tell them about the pickup frisbee games that start up on the arts quad and how if you're walking by, you just jump in. I tell them about freshman year when you're taking prelims in your general classes and there's kind of a mass exodus from Central Campus back up to North and people hand out insomnia cookies or candy along the way. The students are really eager to be a part of a community like that, and the parents are really happy to hear that there's definitely somewhere that their students can eat and there's definitely somewhere they can do their laundry. So it makes everybody happy. Now thinking about orientation, one of the best parts of orientation for our students and their families is moving into the dorm. It's really exciting, and for 3 years I stood outside, rain or sunshine, we've been through it all, and helped people move into their dorm on what we call the best day of the year. This is a lot of fun because everyone's a little different, you know? Some people just show up with two suitcases and that's it, they're ready to go. Some people have a minivan and they got everything nice and organized, and you know, you really do get the rare person that shows up at a U-Haul with all of their stuff and you think, oh boy, you're gonna have a good time here. But the thing is that everyone's excited when they get there, and I think that's because this is when students realize that they're Cornellian, that they're here, that they're joining this community, and for the first time in the next 4 years, they have this true sense of belonging. You know, they think that this is the place that I'm going to call home, this is the place that's really going to introduce me to the next 4 years of my life, and I've loved getting to see that. Everyone at Cornell has a different experience with living, but something that I think is really cool is that everyone has that experience, and that kind of becomes a bonding thing for you. You always ask people, where did you live freshman year, or what was it like your sophomore year? And that's a lot of fun as Cornellians to have one of those shared experiences, especially everybody being at different colleges. The fact that we can come together over the prospect that we all have lived on campus at some point in time is a unique bonding experience. So when I think of unifying experiences in my Cornell career, when I think of character buildings, or going through that process of living in a small dorm and being able to touch all of my things, when I think about diversity and inclusion, and when I think about what prospective students and families looking at our university are excited about, I think of the residential communities. My experience at Cornell would not have been the same without these residential experiences, and so thank you all for coming this morning, for being excited to learn about the future of residences at Cornell, and again, just remember how important it is to invest in this experience and to continue it on for the future students.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Before I begin, I always like to share, this is my favorite view of Calc, because I think it's an opportunity to show how much red everyone owns. to formally introduce myself, my name is Dustin Liu. I am a junior in the ILR school.
All right, ILR!
And to share where my perspective is coming from, I always like to give a shout out to my freshman dorm, Domlin. After my freshman year in Dublin, I became an RA in Dixon.
Yes.
So I like to say that I was a freshman twice. When I think about the topic of the residential experience, I often think, what is the Cornell experience? And that is often a very difficult question to answer. With a multitude of student organizations, interests, groups on campus, it's often easy to fall down to saying the Cornell experience is what you do and where you live and what you study. And that creates a very individualized, siloed experience. Decentralization on Cornell's campus is a double-edged sword. We are physically and geographically segregated based on our field of interest. And while I love talking about labor with people who love talking about labor, sometimes it's really hard to find those who have differing academic perspectives. With 1,000 student organizations on campus, spanning affinity groups and interest groups, sometimes it's very easy to fall into those who share our same interests, who share our same academic interests, who are like us. And in my opinion, that's not taking advantage of what we have here at Cornell. Cornell to me is a very special place where we bring together top talent from around the world to live, learn, and grow from one another. And the residential experience is the place where we can cultivate that. College isn't easy. Freshman year is not easy. I remember that freshman year for me was a year of growth. It was a year of self-discovery. It was also an opportunity to learn. One of my favorite memories from freshman year was sitting with an international student from Mumbai, who is now one of my closest friends at Cornell, and hearing his perspectives on his perceived ideals of American values. And I remember thinking to myself, this is why I'm at Cornell. This moment of sharing life experiences would not be possible without this residential experience, without this Cornell experience. As an RA, this was further exacerbated with the understanding that my residents were challenging their personal identities. They were challenging their preconceived notions. And it's very hard to do that without a community of support, which is exactly what the residential experience offers. It offers us a community to firmly stay in our learning edge and really push against our comfort zone in an effort to grow, learn, and live together. In conclusion, I want to end by thinking about what we want students to take away from Cornell. What we want students, every student, to have. I would argue that one, we want to build that community of support through shared experiences. We want to build that big red family the first second we step on campus. I would also argue that we want to create leaders who have the experience and tools to engage across difference. I am so excited and thankful for Ryan and Ryan's team for investing in the residential experience, because I think that this is the focal point where that all can happen. Thank you so much.
If you didn't know before, you now understand why I have the absolute best job on campus, to get to work with young people like this. But I'm going to invite them to step off the stage for a moment. They'll be back, don't worry, because they're the highlight of the program. But let them take a little break and get a drink of water before we come back in a couple of minutes.
The on-campus residential experience is at the heart of what it means to be a Cornellian. residence halls are where we as students will live, interact, and thrive. They're the first place we enter and where our core journey begins. In the residence halls, we can leave the academic world behind, the worries and stresses of our school group, and enter an even more vibrant world. Cornell residence halls aren't just rooms. They're where we live, where we learn, and where we pursue our passions. The on-campus experience embodies the values of any person, any study, and it is pivotal to the socialization, development, and cultural exploration of all Cornellians.
In case you were missing Ithaca and wanted to get a little shot of the weather up there right now, I talked to my wife this morning, and that's probably about accurate. They hit some snow yesterday, so that's probably a pretty fair representation, though it was filmed a few weeks ago. So I want to tell you a little bit now about where we're going and the future and what this is going to look like for us. 2 years ago, when I got here, we started a housing master planning process. 2 years, you're thinking, what have you been doing for 2 years? You know the Cornell community and you know the investment in major decisions like this. So we've been talking and having dialogue on campus with faculty, staff, students, constituents, alumni. Our Board of Trustees has been highly engaged with this to figure out what we want the future of the residential experience to look like at Cornell. Some of the pivotal points of the timeline were this past summer when the Board of Trustees authorized us to proceed with the growth and expansion of 2,000 new beds, additional beds on campus, and as recently as this past week when they authorized our new residential guiding principles. The future of the Cornell residential experience will be in one in which, in large part, all first and second year students will be able to truly be housed in an on-campus residential experience. We will have a genuine guarantee. We will be able to accommodate all of those students, including our transfer students, in appropriate developmentally appropriate housing, continue our commitment to the first year experience, and continue to support juniors and seniors to the extent that we can moving forward. We'll envision that the third and fourth years continue to be large part in the off-campus realm, though again, we want to stay committed to at least the number of students, juniors and seniors, that we currently house on campus today, which is about 1,200 juniors and seniors that live on campus. In that on-campus 2 years, we think of that broadly. We do believe in the diversity of the residential experience, and so in those first 2 years, all of those options that I spoke about before, the residence halls, the program houses, the Greek system, the co-ops, those types of programs will all be a part of this 2 year residential experience at Cornell. What will be changed, though, is the very large number of second year students who wish to remain on campus, but we could not accommodate without the commensurate space, and unfortunately had to move into an off-campus situation. That has, for those of you who have not been in Ithaca or experienced the housing environment in a while, has created a very untenable situation for our students. One in which a first year student who arrives to Cornell today, within the first 6 to 8 weeks, if they're thinking that they might want to live off campus their second year, they have to be signing a lease already. Leases are being signed 12, 13, 14 months in advance. So here you have students who have barely acclimated to Cornell, and you're already asking them to commit to where they're going to live the next year, who they're going to live with, and to sign a lease for that. That's not a good part of their transition, their growth, and providing that foundation that our students spoke about. They might also decide to wait and go through the Greek recruitment process, or, as you heard a little bit about the housing lottery, take their chances even after Greek recruitment and see if they can get a slot still on campus. Our new trajectory will eliminate the need for all of that strain in those first 2 years. So as we considered where to do this, we had some principles. We know we needed to solve this issue quickly, although you recall that I said in 1961 we were writing about this in the forgotten sophomore. We're ambitious and wanted to move very fast to make sure we could do this construction. So we were looking for sites that we could develop as quickly as possible. Someone told me it wouldn't be the best idea to do this on live slope. So we don't have a lot of space around the West Campus area, as you know that space and the topography over there to expand. So this quickly narrowed us in towards the North Campus environment where we have additional room to grow. As we thought about what we could create up in those spaces on North Campus, we engaged the Mining Scholars, a group of students who received the Mining Award, and helped us think about what this future could look like. They envisioned the concept of a sophomore village, where we remain committed to first-year students on North, but we grow the population of sophomores on North, too, as we provide this additional housing. moving forward. This is a really critical element, and a lot of students in our study of Housing Master Plan talked about the residential experiences feeling like they always had one foot out the door. And now, by creating additional options for second-year students on North Campus with commensurate food and dining and recreation opportunities, it makes for a compelling option up there. One of the other things we've had to do as we've grown is, unfortunately, have to house first-year students in the townhouse complex. That is not the optimal living conditions for a first-year student to facilitate community. So as part of the sophomore village, we'll repurpose the townhouses back into sophomore housing, get the first-year students out of there, and be able to create a great community in that area, in that space. I mentioned this will be 2,000 additional beds, the first phase of which will open in 2021. Our investment and our commitment to doing this moving forward will have a great impact and create, in addition to a residential foundational experience, which is our most important priority here, it will also pragmatically solve a lot of our strengths and issues. You heard the conversation about deferred maintenance and being able to take care and maintain the residence halls that we currently do have. That's of critical importance to us, and we do have a very significant maintenance backlog in our housing inventory. That requires us to have two solutions to solve that. One of which is, of course, the resources to renovate those buildings, but the other is the space. Because some of these buildings need so much repair that they have to be closed down for effectively an entire academic year. So until we grow our capacity, we can't actually do some of the wholesale renovations that need to take place in buildings like Mulch, Risley, the Gothics, all these kinds of things, because those need to be offline for at least a year. And if we did that today, we would further reduce the capacity of what we have on campus and further create strain in the system. So having this additional space on campus will allow us to begin closing down some of those buildings for a period of a year, do a full renovation of them, to preserve the historic integrity of them, to remain committed to them as important parts of Cornell's history, but modernize them and get them up to where they need to be for today's standards. It also will create an opportunity for us to house the students who want to be on campus today, our current students. I mentioned a little bit about this untenable situation we've created with the off-campus marketplace. Even talking to our house professors in the West Campus House System, which has been a phenomenally successful program, they at times lament the fact that many students see that as simply the best real estate, as opposed to being attracted to the living learning experience with the house professors. And so what that creates for them is a difficulty in generating that kind of academic integration environment in those houses, because again, the student just wanted to get in the best environment. I was talking with an alum yesterday, before the lottery process had been revised a couple of years ago, talking to an alum whose son had gone through that process, and explained the stress of that, and explained the stress of the son, I think he's the words, getting voted off the island when they were blocking and trying to get into one of these West Campus houses, and saying that that was, in fact, the single most stressful and unpleasant experience for their student the entire time they were at Cornell. And so that was very difficult. So we'll solve this capacity issue for our current students. We'll be able to start using the townhouses again for the age and the population for which they were designed, and provide more flexibility in general in our housing system. And then finally, we will have the capacity to absorb any additional enrollment growth that takes place. You saw the chart over the years how we've incrementally grown over the last 20 years as an institution. The provost and the deans have been working very closely to try to be strategic about enrollment growth in the future. So instead of the creep that you saw over 20 years, they do want to grow the class of students, but they want to do it strategically and intentionally. And so what we, with these 2,000 new beds on campus, we'll be able to support that growth that the provost and the deans have forecasted. That growth will take place once the buildings are open, but we'll be able to absorb that without creating additional strain on the system. So this plan is incredibly exciting. I think has the opportunity to really transform the student experience. You heard our students talk about the sense of place and the importance of home and creating that sense of place. And this will allow us to take a meaningful step forward as Cornellians to make sure we continue to provide that for our students. So that's the plan moving forward. First phase will open in 2021. We've been working very actively on the design. Next time I'm in front of you, I'll be able to show you renderings and all kinds of exciting stuff like that. Construction will start taking place next academic year on those projects. So with that, I'm going to invite our students back to the stage, and we've got a few minutes where we can engage in some Q&A if there are questions that you might have for either the students or myself. You can see that. Mix it up. All right, so I think, do we have some microphones? Yeah, we've got some microphones going around there too, so we have.
Ryan?
Yes.
Hi, thank you so much. It's very enlightening to hear what the future plan is. In addition to the need to house existing or existing student base that comes in, what is the university's plan strategically for expanding the size of the classes? And while you want to accommodate them from a living concept, how does it impact the rest of the campus in terms of class size? What is the university's goal for continuing to expand? We've had a creep up, and now we're going to have an intentional. Why and how
sure.
much?
Yeah, so I don't want to speak completely for the provost, but I can tell you a little bit about some of the plans around that. A lot of the colleges have expressed interest, and the deans have expressed interest in saying, listen, we have many more qualified and competitive students here at Cornell, and the primary reason we've been saying no to them is because we haven't been able to provide this capacity for them. So many of the deans would like to grow their classes because they have capacity already, without expanding class sizes massively. So they have some areas, some strategic departments that are underutilized, and they would like to fill those in. But part of the plan to grow, though, and the provost has been very thoughtful about this, is to commensurately grow faculty hiring in the units that especially grow, and also student support services as well. So any growth that takes place in terms of that enrollment will also have the commensurate faculty and support services growth as well.
Ryan?
Sorry, I'm having trouble seeing where I'm
sorry. I understand.
Yep. That was the point.
Could you explain the term developmentally appropriate housing?
Sure, please. Developmentally appropriate. Yes, thank you for asking that. So this is the world of which I live, of course. I study human development theory, student development theory. That's what you do when you work in a job like this. And that's the concept, the best example I can give is the fact of having first-year students in an isolated community like the townhouses. Developmentally, as first-year students, they need to be in a communal setting where they can make friends, they can connect with people, and then as a student progresses through the 4 years in their human development and emerges, they move towards more independence and more autonomy. But early on, providing that more communal. So it's developmentally appropriately based on their class year and their personal development.
Good morning. Paul here, class of 91. So Ryan, first off, seeing the methodology and approach of making the stakeholders that you bring to the table and hearing you talk, you know, a lot of the process we're going through, we have fabulous people working on this issue. Question really for everyone, which is the idea of a common experience. And I like the idea. I think that resonates really well. By the way, let me start by saying I don't know the right answer here, so let me throw out a theory. I'd love to get your reaction. The idea of a common experience the freshman year, I think, makes a lot of sense. I think we heard from almost all of our students that first arrive on campus, having a little bit of that structure, I think, facilitates sort of the transition into a major step in their life. But let me ask you a question about the sophomore village. You know, 4 years when you're 18 is a long time, but, you know, if we ask around the room, 4 years goes by very quickly. Do we want to sort of inculcate that common experience in a sophomore village sort of concept? Do we want to more encourage sort of a broadening of horizons rather than sort of segregating students in the same area by class continuing from the sophomore year? And again, don't know the right area there, we'd just love to hear a little more perspective on why we're sort of thinking that direction well into the sophomore year into a common experience.
Sure. I'll start, and then if some of the students want to jump in on this. So again, I see from a developmental perspective, the first year experience being very focused and very shared, and very communal. And what this new process will allow is, as you move into the sophomore experience, there's a much broader variety of options. So there will be the sophomore village on North Campus, but there will also continue to be the West Campus house system, the Greek system, the co-op. So there will be a much broader variety then of options for the second year. So I think of it as kind of like a funnel working upwards, you know, as you move towards senior year, where you have more options as you developmentally progress through those years. But that's my reaction, but I would certainly be curious what students think.
Yeah, so with my interaction with first-year students, I think a lot of people, as Ryan was saying earlier, will move to West Campus if they are able to because of, like, it's the best real estate. It's the newer buildings, everything like that, but not everyone wants to. I know it was hard for me. I did live in the Senior Living Center my sophomore year, and it was again, not where I chose, basically because, but mostly because I didn't have a friend living there with me at the time. But it was much, I was in college, so it was much closer to get to classes. Like, I could get to class in 5 minutes if I needed to, whereas if I lived out west, it probably would have taken me more like 20. Yeah, exactly, it's slow. my only defined muscle is my calf, so. I think more students would choose to live on north if they were able to, if there was more availability of housing, just because of the location thing, but also the communities that people want to live there, program houses, et cetera.
I'll add to that really quickly that when you're a sophomore, you know a little bit more about what you want. When you come in as a freshman, everybody's kind of tossed in the pond of living together, but you start to figure out, oh, I like this idea of apartment-style living. I like the idea of still having a dining hall in my building. I like the idea of being independent and going to live in a co-op. So the more opportunities and the more varied living experiences that you can make available to students their sophomore year will really encourage them to stay on campus and make sure that every different kind of student has somewhere that they're comfortable living in an environment they enjoy.
Hi, I'd like to ask about the options for students who choose to spend a semester or a year studying abroad or otherwise living off of campus and away from the Cornell environment. I know in my experience, I studied abroad in the fall in my junior year, which if you're not familiar, is not the most common semester to study abroad, which made it very difficult. And quite frankly, I wouldn't have found housing for both the spring I came back and my senior year had I not been able to rely on my friends. I applied for different programs such as the Language House on West Campus and was not lucky enough to find housing there. So I'd just like to ask about how you're considering those students in your plans.
That's a great question, and I think one of the benefits of having this additional housing will be there will be more slack in the system so that as students come and go, whether it's abroad or for other reasons, there will just be more capacity. We won't be at 100% every single semester, every single time, so there's never any release valve, if you will, or things like that. So I think it's going to hopefully put ease some of that strain for students who do choose to go away at different points of their experience.
Fantastic. And if I can ask a quick follow-up, is there any plan in order to bring awareness to students as they're planning to study abroad or leave campus so that way they can maybe take their time while still on the campus to make plans before they are away from school?
It's a great suggestion. Yes, we've been talking about that with our global abroad and our study abroad folks. And I'm sorry, I didn't hear, there's a little bit of an echo, so I didn't hear the question exactly. But great suggestion, and we have been talking about that, but as we roll into phase one, we'll be more intentional about thinking about how we accomplish that.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hi, over here. Yes, my name is Megan Angel-Sazay, class of 96. I just wanted to know if there were any specific plans to enhance or renovate the program houses on North Campus, because I know it's been several years since any work has been done to them. And since you're talking about the expansion of your residential programs, is there anything that you haven't planned for those program houses?
So you saw that one of the outcomes of this will be that our ability to begin addressing some of the deferred maintenance needs and updating some of the existing structures. I will say that the first structure that we plan to do a mass renovation on is Balch Hall. That will be the first one just because as we've assessed the portfolio of options, that is the one that's in the worst shape right now. Sorry. but we will begin also investing in all of our properties, all of our residences, including program houses, smaller houses, the other major ones, as I mentioned, Gothics and some of those kinds of things. So that's very much a part of the plan, but we have to get our capacity where it is so that we can begin to make some of those meaningful renovations in those spaces. We haven't slated an exact timeline yet for that one. We're as far as knowing that Balch is going to be our first. We haven't yet set a timeline for exactly the sequence after that yet.
Hi. I was curious if you could talk a little bit about the junior and senior years in terms of housing. A lot of students choose to move off campus and, you know, rent has gotten incredibly high in college town. It's not as easy for students to, negotiate with their landlords or bring up all the necessary things that need to happen and providing a safe and caring environment while they're at Cornell. So I was curious if the university has any plans to negotiate more with landlords or conduct more programs concerning off-campus living in junior and senior years.
I'll say a word and then there might be advice for students to learn. That answers your question too, but I'm happy, and I appreciate you asking that. Like I said, it's created a really untenable situation. The rents in College Town off campus are astronomical. The condition is not always as we would hope for it to be in terms of the quality for our students and for what they're paying. And the first most meaningful change would be a market effect here, right? So if there are effectively 1,000 fewer students in their second year moving off campus, I would think that would have a market impact, right? So it could have the impact of softening the market from a rent perspective, hopefully maybe incentivizing some landlords to do a better job with keeping up their properties and making them attractive. For those of you who are market economists, you can debate that with me, but I think we would hope that that will happen. But I will say, before I see if there are any students want to comment on this, we have had a couple of conversations in our privately with a few of the developers in College Town who are scooping up and purchasing some of the old residential properties and trying to convert them to higher quality, safer, code-compliant types of properties moving forward. And I will say the one thing I always bring to bear in that conversation, they always ask, what do students want? What do students want off campus? And I say the number one thing is affordability. Make sure that these are at an affordable price point that, it's not so high. But I don't know if any of the students have perspective on this off campus.
I think I just want to refer to something that Ryan brought up. Finding housing that's off campus, that's affordable, safe, and close to campus is near to impossible. And by having these options, definitely, going back to what Ryan was saying, it will allow for that freeing up that a lot of students feel moves really too quickly throughout their Cornell experience. So having that market effect will definitely ameliorate that problem or help solve. Begin solving that problem.
I'll share one other update that we launched this past spring, summer, was a new off-campus safety rating database. So we have an off-campus housing database where off-campus properties can list and post their properties for rent on our website. What we did is we worked with the city of Ithaca to take all of the files and the data about those various properties when they were last inspected, what fire suppression systems they have, what code compliance they have, to digitize that and then put it on this database website. So with the click of a mouse now, a student can see the conditions of certain properties they're looking at. Some of the landlords aren't very happy with this because some of their properties are getting very low star rankings on there. But frankly, my job's not to please the landlords, it's to support our students. And so it's been a good step forward. We need to continue to expand those types of things too to help more students.
Good morning, Howard Greenstein, 88, parent of 20. And
you've experienced this on
multiple. Oh yes, no, we've looked through the housing contract very recently. So I noticed that several of the students mentioned that part of home is having a meal together. And I've noticed that since the time that we left campus, there's still for dining experience, for Cornell Dining, Oak and Shields. And if you're studying in plant science or the dairy bar area or out in the far reaches of the engineering quad, there's really not a great place to have meals with your current, with your freshman friends, except for going back to the North Campus and going to one of the two student unions there. I'm wondering whether there's plans as we expand housing to expand dining in the central campus area that's on the meal plan and not just for the big red box or the cash system.
So first of all, when we do the North Campus expansion, we will be adding additional dining up there. And I will say, on campus, I've heard this repeatedly since I've been here, we are currently exploring and we haven't made a final decision yet, but we're looking very seriously at converting Trillium, which is on the ag quad, into a swipe kind of all-you-can-eat. So, I know there are students in the room, so this will probably be in the sun tomorrow. But we haven't made a final decision, but we do think it's going to be viable, and we think we'll be able to provide this before too terribly long. So, and that's a pretty popular location, especially in some of those areas that you were talking about.
I have a question for the four students. This is a CAECO conference, which is focused on classes. And it was my understanding that when North Campus was originally built, one of the side effects of housing all freshmen together was to foster a strong sense of class unity. And I'm wondering whether that's still working with the current housing systems, because We've noticed that there's been a sharp drop-off in dues paying for the classes as we get younger and younger. I wonder if you have a strong sense of class identity, or whether you're, I'm not questioning anybody's loyalty to Cornell University, because we all have a strong sense of loyalty to the university, but whether you have a strong sense of class as well.
I'll start with that one. So this is, since I only lived on North freshman year, a few of the other students have experiences living on North multiple years, but for me, whenever I go back to North campus, no matter what I'm doing up there, it reminds me that I'm a part of the class of 2018, because that was my freshman experience. That's when we were all kind of in this North campus bubble together. So that's always stuck in my mind, as when I'm back up there, I do think about my class. So to your point, I think the system does encourage an optimism and coherency within the classes themselves, because they have that opportunity to bond and stick together, and it's something they remember across their 4 years.
Yeah, I want to echo that. I think my first year, like, sometimes I would spend upwards of 2 hours in RPCC eating dinner, because I would go with a group of friends, and then I would like walk my plate to the dish dispenser where you put your, after you put your plates back, and I would see someone else, and so I would sit down with them, and I would do the same thing, and like, I would spend sometimes upwards of 2 hours and I didn't have too much work to do, so I do think I had a strong sense of class identity while living on North campus.
So I appreciate the sentiments shared by my partners here, but I can't echo that sense of class-based salience. There are a number of different communities at Cornell that have, in some ways, transformed my sense of self and my desire to contribute meaningfully to Cornell, but I don't know if it's the year I graduated that's really salient for me. We can talk about a number of different things, but the year I graduated isn't necessarily the top thing on my mind.
My perceptions are similar to Keon's. I feel a much more organizational affinity to the groups on campus that I participated in and build strong relationships in. The people who I'm living with senior year are not necessarily from my class, but they're from the groups on campus that I have joined and I've created really close relationships with. So through that, in my own personal experience, I feel a stronger affinity to groups that I join rather than my class.
Unfortunately, we've run out of time. We've got a great big clock up here staring at us, telling us that we're running low on time. I really appreciate the questions that you have here. I'm very excited as we move forward to keep you informed and share updates with you. If we could have another round of applause for the students. I hope this was informative for you to get a little bit of sense of the direction that we're going, the impact that this hopefully will have on our future Cornellians. As you move about the day, I do encourage you and remind you to attend some of the sessions on the core competencies for volunteer opportunities. And I hope you have an incredible rest of your weekend. Get out of Philly before the Super Bowl hits, especially if they win, because it'll be pandemonium. And I wish you safe travels, and I look forward to seeing you again soon. Thank you very much.